Okay.
Should you record it?
All right. So hello. Who doesn't know me? My name is Suchý, and I will give you together with my colleague Miroslav overview what happened in Copr during past year. 1 year is long period, so you are maybe familiar with some improvements and changes we done in Copr, but some may be surprises for you. So let's go. So what happened? Before we start, let's talk about some statistics. In Copr we have right now 50,000 projects. Whatever it means. One project is usually one YAML repository. Sometimes it's some very good project, sometimes not, usually not. But yeah, lot of projects. We have 30 terabyte packages. And previous month we served 13 terabyte from our repository. So there was outgoing traffic. What we done, the oldest change was old PC 64 with the end builders. Then we added that during autumn. Originally, still is kind of experimental stuff because it doesn't reside in Fedora infrastructure. It resides in Brno on Technical University where we have our PC machine. So we copy the bits over the ocean, so it's not optimal, but it will change soon because we right now have the PowerPC machines in OpenStack and they will be available pretty soon, so it will be more robust. DNF, we started using DNF in Koji, in Copr quite soon. It was the base work was done, Michal Šimáček, who done the support more. And you probably never noticed when the DNF was deployed in Koji, because there was no such problem. We have few problems in Copr and in Mock, and we fixed that before it was deployed into the Koji, which I think was good role of the Copr to find the issues before it hit the Koji, where a lot of people will complain. If we have problems in Copr, people usually email us or ping us, it doesn't work again and again, but actually it doesn't break so much stuff. Dist-git. You remember previously you have to provide Copr just some address on the internet and where you have your source RPM and Copr download those source RPM. For several months we have Dist-git so you can upload source RPM from your workstation. It's stored in the Dist-git and we build from that Dist-git. It's not publicly open for writing for anyone. You still have to upload it to our front end, which upload it to Dist-git, which is only configured for only one user. But you can clone it and use it in your anonymous mode if you want. It's not open for normal user for writing because we were afraid of some performance problems because we have 150,000 gigs and some projects are not capable to work with such huge numbers. For example, recently we had a performance problems with CG, which is the web interface for the Dist-git, which was not able to handle such number of gigs, just rendering the front page to 30 minutes. So it timeouts and even with the caching enabled cause us a lot of soft problems. Groups. from the start of the Copr, there was access control list, so we were able to assign somebody else and give him permission to build or even administrate your project. But there was a problem that the owner, name of the owner, was still visible in the name of the project. So if you start a project like msuki/copr, and then you have the project, it was still visible in that name of the project, and people don't like that and ask us for the groups at all. So we done that, so you can have the groups. They are related to fast groups, because we say, okay, let's not write another account system when we have one for the account system. So if you have group in fast, you can enable that group in Copr, give it that group some other name. So if the group in the fast is named git mock, you can name it mock in Copr, so it looks like better in the output. If you want to use that feature, there is one problem, because fast couldn't create on the fly the group. There is no such button like create a group. It's still ticket the driver, so you have to write ticket to Fedora infrastructure and ask them, please create a group. I need that for Copr. I need this guy. They will do that. It takes several hours or day to create that. So it's not real time thing. But I expect that more people will use that, and then somebody in infrastructure will create such a button and automate that. Webhooks. We support webhooks right now only again GitHub. But if you go to the settings, there is a tab settings in Copr project. There is a tab webhooks, and it will provide you some address on Copr, and you can copy and paste it into the GitHub settings, and GitHub will notify Copr server after each commit, and Copr can trigger build of package. Question?
I saw this feature, I didn't try it yet. Does it require the sources and the spec file to be at the same repository?
Right now, it's only built from GitHub. If your package used in upstream Pito or is capable of build using mock SCM. And mock SCM have the problems that there is right now no way to automatically bump the release or version even. But if you go to the mock homepage, and there is a plugin SCF, and it will tell you how to run mock SCM against some Git repository. So if you succeed building your package using mock SCM, that will work in Copr. It's not optimal. I see a lot of space for improvements, but that has to be done in mock SCM, which eventually will end up on me, as I'm right now making mock mainly. But yeah, it's not work for the Copr. And biggest work we are doing right now is we are building some native modules. We started with Python modules. They said, okay, there exist 70,000 Python modules on PyPI. But we have in Fedora only 2,000, 3,000 Python modules. So people are installing those modules using pip install name of the modules. it should be problems. You couldn't verify the signature because there is none. You couldn't remove that. All the problems why we are using packages. So let's rebuild whole PyPI as RPM packages. There is the tool pip2rpm, and we created all those source RPM using pip2rpm. There was a lot of problems, but we are reporting them to pip2rpm maintainer, Michal Cyprian. He's working on fixing that. The biggest improvement recently, and was contributed by Nikon Rapa, was that previously pip2rpm was trying to parsing the setup.py as normal text, which of course is not used as normal text because a lot of maintainers are putting the version is equal to open some file, read the contents, and take the first line or something like that. So it's not possible by aspects, it must be evaluated. So Komaraka contributed the code which evaluated the setup file, and we will get the variables when they are evaluated by Python. So we have we rebuilt all those 70 modules. Right now it's only as Python 2 and separate project with Python 3. And we have right now 22% success rate, which means we have 15,000 Python packages available. It's quite a lot. But honestly, we don't know what quality it is. So it may work or not, but it is. So it may be, you may try it, and if it works for you, it's good. Or somebody from Fedora QA can step in and try to test all those 15,000 packages. So it's playground for you, and you can do something with that. I don't know what. I'm just providing those packages. Question.
What about the
Python packages was built just for the rawhide, because I was trying to get some statistics which packages we are able to build for Python 2 and for Python 3, and then I want to build the mixture of them. Final project where there be a combination of those. Although it has sense. So, but I am waiting for a few improvements in pip2rpm, which I report.
Question. How do you handle interdependencies between those five packages?
Right now, I don't handle it at all. So if it fails because of the dependency, it fails. So I just submit those packages according to the alphabet order. So which is not optimal. I will talk about it later as feature set. There is a project in DNF, and they plan to provide API in DNF for sorting using built requirements in DNF. So some API and command line tools. So we are working on them. And setup by parsing I mentioned, and Python 2 and Python 3 and the meter was the biggest problem. So sometimes even the modules support Python 3, but not the setup by. So that was the most problem. But in the meantime, we started with Ruby games. This time, Ruby games are much easier. I didn't anticipate it, but the fact is that there are not too much problems. And we have even 43 success rate, which means we right now provide 28,000 packages. It was a week ago, right now it will be even more. For Fedora, This time it's for Fedora rawhide, Fedora 24, 23, I think I'm not sure it's 22, and Apple 7. So that's a lot of packages. This finally submit them there, and there is a queue, and still 80,000 builds are waiting to be done. But I know this whole rebuild is has taken about 1 month, so it's quite a lot of time. You are trying to focus on the speed improvements, but still, even if you the build of the game lasts 1 minute, which is super fast, counting in the build room preparation, so it's super fast. But still, if you count the 1 minute, there are more than 100,000 games, and if you count it, Fedoras, Apples, it's a huge number. We had some problems in the rudiments though. For example, my favorite one, there is one rude game, it's never this way. It caused us we didn't have so long the column DB, so we have to change the DB.
Does it actually do something, or is it a joke?
I don't know. The description of the game is, I hope I didn't step into someone else's namespace. So I don't know what it actually does, but it blocked our queue for a few days.
It's a test case, so the test serves some purpose. In the
yeah.
I
feel
like the guy that made that had like three attempts to get in his own namespace and found what people were having. He's like, no one's going to check my namespace.
Yeah. But the biggest issue was the license issue, because a lot of game maintainers doesn't provide any license information regarding the game. And rubygem.org website license is, if maintainer doesn't provide license information, then it defaults to all rights are reserved, which means no redistribution, no free use. I know that this is just that the author just didn't care about the license, and they basically can license it using what the fuck license. But yeah, you don't have those licenses, and it's a huge number. I said previously we have 46% success rate, but it's approximately 50% of those games doesn't have the license, so we probably fail only with 70% of games, actually. So, and it's so much, so many games that I couldn't do anything about it. I couldn't contact 50,000 mediators. But I thought about it, and I probably can. I probably contact all the games and ask them to send some huge spam to all the those editors, and kindly ask them if they can provide some license. So we will see if we can do something.
Maybe another heuristic would be to actually check if that gem is a dependency of any important gem, or maybe even any gem. You know,
yeah.
So you would cut off the let's say, I don't know, the gems that people even don't care to put a license on.
Yeah.
So you didn't have license issues with Python?
No. There may be some packages which have such problems, but it's not the problem is not such huge as in Ruby games. There are probably few of them. But Python maintainers are pretty good with license. Okay, and last slide from me, it's Forest. It's quite a recent feature. There is available the button fork, which enable you to fork your project or some other project into some of your namespace, into your namespace or the group namespace. The intended use is that you have your project where you have 90 builds, or even after each commit, call it my project 90s, and you build there, and then suddenly you decide that you want to do a release. So you fork your 90 project into your my project stable, it will copy, sorry, it will copy latest successful builds into your new project, my project stable, resign them with the new project GPG key, and since that moment you continue with your my project libraries and you have your libraries there, but you are trying to stabilize my project stable and only put the fixes there and stabilize that and say, okay, from this point it's stable and I'm releasing to community, use this project with this DNF repository as it contains stable version of my project. And now I will give place for Michael, who will show you where the fork button is.
I'd like to show that actually.
I will just show the Copr CLI interface.
Okay.
And there is a top.
Okay, so is you have to be logged in, otherwise it will not be shown. And the bottom of the page, so fork this project, and if you click on that, it will say, okay, fork it into the either client or some group you are a member of, and some name, so Copr demo, and fork it. And say it's being prepared, and now backend will copy all those bits and will resign all those packages, which may take some time, even a few minutes or dozen minutes, but then it's prepared for use.
This is great. I actually came here because I was going to ask you for something like this. So
okay, I will send this back in then. It's a new session for you.
Perfect. Just one question. So, in this case, it looks like Copr demo was pre-existing.
What dysfunctionality in production? Or
okay. So
I got it. Okay. So the question was, what will happen if this project to which I'm forking already exists? If it already exists, it will put there those new RPMs. If that project doesn't exist, it is created, but if it exists, it just copy those packages.
I'm not sure about this. I think it's forbidden.
No.
Some tests by a group, and I think it's forbidden actually, but you cannot do that.
No. He worked on that, and it's allowed. Policy of the Copr will step into the place, so suddenly those previous builds are older ones, so they can be pruned and removed if they are older than 14 days. So, so on those latest one, you copied there and will stay.
Okay, so I can still fork to an existing.
Yes.
I have exactly. I mean, right now I have a stable-ish repository, mm-hmm. but I'd like to be able to do a test build, run my own test against it, and if it looks good, then move it to this repository that I have, and that should work.
Yeah. Okay. For example, you can have your project nightly, mm-hmm. your project stable, right. which is always used, and you have your project release candidate, so you can fork nightly to release candidate. Fix those few packages which you find some problems, and when you are happy with that, you fork the release candidate into the stable.
That's great. Thank you. Um, So it just to be certain, it's not going to rebuild the arc, yeah, just resign.
No, you will just copy them, or we didn't even copy those build three cores, but I think Jakub told me that right now we have copied even those build three cores, so we have the entry in the build tab.
And what happens with the git repo that we had? So what happens with the these git commits and so on?
It's not created, those entries will still refer to the previous this git, but so it's not copied to this git of that new project, but since it's not too much visible for the user, we didn't care too much, so.
Yeah, because I think the functionality, maybe the name fork is then a bit misleading, I think. Maybe we could
come up with a better one.
Yeah, I don't have one.
Yeah.
I'm saying that people are used to, I don't know, fork is a name of GitHub.
Yeah, so we are open to ideas. I was, somebody else come and request this feature, and we want to have this feature easy to use. So we doesn't care about too much as the lines do about the relation between this git and reproducible builds. So if it works for the end user, it's enough for us. So we are aiming for easy to use.
Are you actually aiming for this git to, in some point in the future, to be usable as, like, I don't know, Copr perfect build, whatever?
You can use it right now, you can perfect build.
But you can only read from the repository.
You can read.
And then do you think at some point in the future we'll be able to write?
Yeah, we can, but first we have to work and check if GitLab is capable to handle so many users and so many gits. And I'm not sure the video will work for us.
Maybe you can try a year and make it a stress test for it.
Oh, that would be nice.
Have you been on the infra talk?
Yeah.
Yeah, so they are applying it for packages in Fedora now. So probably you have more packages in Copr, but still a lot of packages, I guess. So.
Yeah. We have a lot of ideas, a lot of things to do, just human power, so.
And one more question out of curiosity, if I go to the PyPI repo and I click fork, will I disable Copr for months? Yes. Then it will be signing all these packages?
Because they will not be rebuilt, just copy. They will just copy few gigabytes, so you will probably probably disable the signing for a day or two or three, but not months, yeah.
Okay, that's not the best.
I mean,
the noise
too. Yeah, everybody does. Okay.
Michael, can you show the demonstration of your
few things?
So my name is Klein.
Hello.
And I would like you to see some cool things that you can do with Copr CLI interface.
So let's see. So first thing that I will do is creating a new project. Okay, and now recently there were many projects on the whole page that were automatically generated RPM software git overlay or something like that, and it was just spamming our homepage. So we decided to implement some feature that would enable us to hide those projects. Actually, it was a feature request, thank you for that, and we implemented it, and it works like this. Right now this Copr is visible. Okay. Yeah. So, climb my Copr, and I will hide it. Oh, sorry. So now it should be hidden. And now I can make it visible again. So right now this option is not used by Git overlay group, but Igor Ignat and Copr promised me that he will use it eventually. So I hope he will do it.
The intended use is that if you are using your project for continuous integration, for example, our RPM team is using that, they are creating for every pull request, they create the new project. And so they spend it one page with a lot of projects which no one but the RPM team cares about. So they can be not listed on the homepage.
This is one of the features that we implemented recently. And another issue that we have had was that when we started these massive rebuilds of PyPI and RubyGems, it completely stopped other builds from happening. You know, it like blocked our build queue, and other builds didn't take their turn at all. So we needed to figure something out to fix this. And what we did was that we introduced priorities, but in a very simple fashion. So we introduced Copr CLI build news minus minus background, dash dash background. And this will make the build a background job, which means that it will be overtaken by a normal job if it comes in the queue. So normal jobs have precedence in Copr. And background job will be built only if there is no normal job. So I'll make a small demonstration. I hope it won't take too much time.
Difference between Copr and Copr CLI?
No difference.
Okay.
So why do you have two?
Sir?
Why do you have two tools then?
It's one tool. It's just alias, and I'm usually using this, but
Copr CLI was first.
I'm trying to learn using this
simple Copr command, so maybe alias.
Okay, so I will make a gem build. So build gem A123 into my Copr. And it will be the ground, and I don't want to, well, I don't want my shell to be blended. So this is a background job, and I will also send at the same time, but after the gem job, normal job.
Is there any user limiting?
Sorry?
Is there any user limiting? For example, could the user spam the Copr to the build?
Of course. Yeah, well, actually, our virtual machines, there is a limit in our backend that only, like, for example, 8 machines can belong to one user. So after that, this build still will be sent into the queue, build queue, and it can block other users, yes. If they don't use backend priority, then
well, we have 25 builders, I think, right now we use. So and only six builders can be bound to one user. So if you have 6 parallel builds, then we take builds from other users. So,
so now what will happen?
Probably not.
Is that first the gem build is created, and after it, the normal job, normal this prune repo build, prune repo package is built. ID 33 is prune repo normal build, and it was sent after the gem build. So gem build should be first to be built, but it will be second. So let's have a look. Yes, you can see that prune repo is running, the build is running, and gem is still waiting, so it will be built after. Alright, and the very last thing I want to show you is our cool package interface. So you can create and edit packages directly from command line. For example, I will create Twitter package. Okay, and name will be example, Microsoft, sorry. And now, why is this good? It is good because you can do build package command. And it will use the definition of the package that you defined when you created it. And you don't need to specify it again and again. So if you have more arguments, more parameters that you want to define your package with, because there are more, git url, git dir, git bench, this can be useful. You don't need to specify it every time again if you make a new build with this command. Okay, so any questions to it?
This is stored on server or on file?
This packages are created on the server, yes. You can,
do you expect users to use the background priority that won't be nice? Or is it especially for...
I'm not sure now, because right now we use them for that IPI Ruby threader. So if you can submit package with background priorities and in 1 month it will be ideal. But later when we stop with all those huge queues, we expect that it will be used for continuous integration. So if you have continuous integration and you don't care if it's built in half an hour or an hour, use background and normal users who have the page and build more faster.
So background is just a boolean, or can a task be more or less background?
It's just a boolean, and we have two priorities. Mm-hmm. So.
Then you demo the background thingy. Oh. The server received request for a background package.
Yes.
And the student immediately started it?
No, because...
It waits a couple of seconds, or...?
Yeah. Our background is pulling our front end for new build. And it does it every 30 seconds. So I was hoping that it won't do it first.
So it could have actually happened.
Yes, it could.
Yeah.
Okay, I just, you can see that the packages were created in our cell. So that's all for me.
Status command, I think. What is it? Is there? Over CLI status, so I of the build.
The build is done? Or
yeah, the question was how he knows that the build is done.
If the builds are of the concern, then you can use Copr CLI watch build and ID of the build command, and it will join to the proceeding build, and will display its status as it goes.
It's similar to Koji command, the watch build as well.
Also, you have Fed message, so you can use Fedora notifications and set up emails or whatever.
And there is a Fed watch command by Stanovnitsky, and you can execute anything when you receive a successful build Fed message. So that's what we are. So what what can happen in the future. So we are nearly done with Ruby gems. We are somewhere in the middle with PyPI, but there are other languages, Node.js, C, Palm. So why not triple bend those as well? So very likely happen. Something from internal, we will like really have, and we are in the progress of redesigning called the queue logic to better utilize resources, to build faster. Igor Natenko is initially started project for common RPM creation tools because right now there is a blog, Tito, Mock, RDO, PKG, and other which are running somehow from upstream created the package. And I've seen in Copr that every project created RPM some different way. We have for a long time the RPM dev package where the RPM dev bump spec, RPM, changelog, entry, etc. But yeah, we are targeting, Igor is targeting to have some common tools which are better suited for these days, so other tools can utilize it, and maybe we will converge to some better tools or just few of them which will be commonly used. I mentioned that DNF team is working on package ordering, which will help better with bootstrapping. So if you start new pool with KDA, there is 100 packages and you have to sell them in specific order, otherwise you will fail and you have to resubmit. So that will help as well. And there is of course the big topic of Fedora modules, was mentioned today by Matthew, and there will be demo on Wednesday and maybe on Friday by Thursday, Friday.
On Thursday
by London. So I encourage you to visit there so you know what Fedora modules are. And very likely Copr will be able to build them as well. It's somehow able to build it in our development environment right now. I'm trying to focus on Mock with systemd and spawn, because right now Mock is building with Crude. For more than a year, we have the code contributed by Michal Šimáček as part of his Google Summer of Code work, which enable Mock to build in container, systemd and spawn. There are still some bugs which prevent us to deploy that in production, and once fixed, we can probably very easily switch that to other container like Docker or Sourcehole, so you can build packages in containers. Fedora modularity, I have the price there. And generally, I'm open to any idea which is related to continuous integration or building directly from upstream. So if you have any idea which may help you or somebody else, I'm open to your idea, and we probably can use something about that.
So what's the easiest way to get in touch with you guys to submit feature requests or
Copr demo mailing list.
Okay.
That's probably the commonplace, or we are hanging on buses on IRC Freenode. So if you want to chat with us, then IRC is probably the best. If you have some more longer idea, then email on the mailing list is better. you may open a feature request enhancement in Bugzilla component Copr. We are ready to work on that. Or you can discuss with us here, and we'll talk about your ideas.
Another thing that, if this is involved, I can talk to you later about, but Copr's great. I love Copr. It's awesome. I use it primarily to build kernels, and so that takes a couple hours. And I've noticed kind of a disturbing trend over the past few months where it's getting less and less reliable for building kernels. Things time out, there's runs out of disk space, there's a problem with setting up the mock environment. And sometimes I have to resubmit jobs 3-4 times. And the problem is, I've even noticed it seems like the Copr tries to build something and then I get kicked off the timeout or something, so it restarts again. So one Copr build might take 6 or 7 hours, and at the end of 6 or 7 hours it fails. And so I've basically lost half a day to a day waiting on this and I have to resubmit it. So, is that something you guys are aware of, and it's hopefully maybe just temporary, and it will get better?
Yeah, so for the record, the question was that Copr sucks recently and have a lot of issues. Yes, we are aware of that, and we are trying to fix it as hard as we can. But at the same time, we were breaking that because we were putting those new features into production, and then we was mad with, okay, this sucks and this was broken. So right now we don't have any big disruptive plan in future, because most of those problems was by those new troubles which caused the some services time out, or
I wonder,
there was a lot of needs, etc. So we are trying to change the queue logic, which may again bring some new bugs, but probably only some delay and not errors per se. But yeah, we are fine. We are not breaking it just for fun.
I understand.
I hope that right now there will be more like season of more stable Copr. That's my wish as well.
Hey, it's still a great project. I still love it. So thank you guys very much. Really appreciate it.
Other questions? Yeah.
Do you have like an example project that maybe uses Copr to produce, let's say, IPL artifacts automatically? So, for example, when you would, I don't know, push a tag to Git repo, it would, for example, use GitHub and it would trigger the webhook of Copr.
Copr/Copr, our main repository, or Copr dev, Copr/Copr dev. There are configured packages. Which are configured again GitHub, and anytime we push anything to GitHub, it will submit a new build into the Copr, into our project, Copr Lab.
So in other words, we build Copr in Copr and install Copr from itself. Okay, that is a Copr Dev project. So you don't do like, I don't know.
But for example, RPM team have set up that they have those project on GitHub as well, and anytime the pull request will come, they have Travis set up which will create the project in Copr, submit to the package into the Copr, fetch this result and submit it into the pull request command. So they notify if the pull request broke something or not.
So yeah, okay, there's no support for, let's say, GitHub commit status API, so the Copr would, I don't know, be able to put a tick on the GitHub pull request. So you have to do it via Travis now.
The main problem is how you build your RPM. Because right now the best way is to use Twitter for loading. That's only reasonable way which is able to bump up release correctly. But yeah, I know that only few projects use Twitter. Not everyone is fan of that project. So if you help me to find a way how to build the RPM, source RPM from GitHub reasonably, not just for you, but at least for two or three other people, then we may put that chain into the Copr. But right now, everyone has different way.
Okay.
It's not even make RPMs like, okay, I have shell script, I have make RPM, other have CMake, other have, I don't know what. So everyone has different way.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Can you figure out how to build RPM from any GitHub, whatever? Is it possible to say only build on packed builds or report back to GitHub? Or something like that. Is that something you plan to integrate more? Because now you have a webhook, you just copy paste it somewhere, and then every comment it triggers a build, and that's it, right?
Yeah, but is that, are those people on file which you made?
Hmm?
Those build success, build failure, is it live in your action? Because Arab was exactly working on that.
I guess
I
yeah,
that
no,
you
yeah,
can.
No, if you can build some just tags for every commit, right? It builds actually every commit, but if you don't check the text, flag in the video, I guess it will try to rebuild the package, but nothing happens. So it's like kind of cool.
It will
the latest tag. If
yes.
Okay.
With Twitter you can build latest tag only, not every commit. And Adam worked on feature where we have address which you can paste in GitHub readme, and we're under nice icon build successful, build error, or build unknown. And I was asking whether it is in production or not.
I don't know.
But we have it ready.
Is there any progress with regards to RFR process in Fedora infra? So making it support service, at least the back end and the front end?
No, unfortunately no progress. I have other priorities recently, which comes from where I left, which pay my wages, but yeah. Yeah, I will have to focus on that more. It will probably happen in the near future, which will mean that we will replace Copr Fedora Infra Cloud.org with a new service which will be named as the old name Copr Fedora Project.org, but it will be probably different service. Which will look like the same, but on different hardware and different SLI. Okay, it seems we are running out of time. So that's everything. And if you have any question regarding Copr, ask any guy with this t-shirt and he will try to help you.
Thanks to the recording.